Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Those of you that have come in the hall have made a wise choice. Before I introduce our speaker for this particular keynote address, I want to just make a few very brief announcements. Tomorrow, as you know, we'll be downtown in Benaroya Hall. And be sure to stay in touch with what it says in your program relative to bus service. It is not as frequent tomorrow, and just, you know, you don't want to get caught missing the bus. Tonight, after Long Beach State's concert, there'll be a wonderful reception upstairs. We had a great one last night, free food, free alcohol. We threw out a lot of food last night, which makes me feel bad. Come and eat. Saturday, a couple important things. One is that the parking garage, the central parking garage off of 15th Avenue, the entrance to that parking garage will be closed for the only day this year. And so we want to allow extra time if you're in a rental car. And then lastly, in the program on Saturday, again, there's an 11:45 listed time for George Schwartz's keynote address. That'll be pushed back to noon, just so you know, because to accommodate the maestro's schedule. My colleague, who you're about to meet, Larry Starr, has been at the University of Washington for 34 years. And he's an outstanding scholar, researcher, and most importantly, teacher. You know, when you work with somebody as long as I've worked with Larry, you struggle to come up with the right words. So I sort of beat the internet up to find out what critics would say about his most recent publications, of which he's written several books. And you find, you know, the typical folderol, one from the Wall Street Journal just recently, an admirable effort to understand Gershwin, his career, and how the productions shaped him as a composer. Well, that's prototypical. But I continued to hunt, and in the London Telegraph, I found just a tail end of a sentence that I think really describes him. The author's intelligence and affection shine through. And here at the UW, when I counsel my graduate students in conducting about what they should do to fulfill music history electives, it's been a constant theme for me to be sure you take a Larry Starr class. He's an amazing classroom teacher, has been lauded with numerous awards for his classroom teaching. And so I want to just let him talk to you about the band as the center of musical American life. Please welcome Larry Starr.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you very much. Scholars tend to talk too much, so let's start with some music, please. A lot of you recognize this music, I'm sure. Some of you may recognize it as Putnam's Camp, the second movement of Charles Ives' Three Places in New England. Others may recognize it more as its source piece, the Country Band March, which is programmed frequently, as Tim Salzman tells me, by college bands around the country, and it's been played by the UW Symphonic Wind Ensemble as well. But this piece is best known, of course, in its orchestral guise as part of Three Places in New England. And one of the things I would observe about this piece is that to understand this piece at all, it is necessary to understand the traditions from which it came, which are the traditions of American band life and American band traditions. And the question is, while this piece is played and has been recorded by numerous symphony orchestras and is studied by scholars, I tend to wonder what role such an understanding of the American band tradition, plays in the education of today's orchestra players, symphonic conductors, music historians, and theorists who teach this music. My guess would be, with a couple of prominent exceptions, close to absolute zero would be the familiarity with the American band traditions from which this piece came. And I offer myself as a sterling example of this absolute zero. In my own education, I received a thorough background as an undergraduate at Queens College, City University of New York, and then as a graduate student at the University of California at Berkeley, purportedly one of the two or three top schools for training musicologists in the country. I have taught for many years, And nowhere in my education was there so much as a mention of American band music, anywhere. I'm trusting that this situation does not surprise you very much. Band music is, of course, live and well, and its traditions are, but to a significant degree, I would say, and I hope no one will be offended by this, that it is marginalized, if not actually ghettoized, in American music. I think an organization like this is at once sort of a response to that and a bulwark against it, but you end up in sort of a circulating kind of condition where organizations that promote a particular kind of music end up themselves being segregated as where this music is heard and promoted, and there isn't that much interaction with the large community of American musical life outside of it. I'll return to this situation very shortly. And I want to tell you in advance that I have no solutions for it. So if you're looking for me to give an answer as to how we can get American band traditions, the history of American band music, the importance of contemporary American band music out of the margins, I do not have an answer. And if you want to walk out now, that's okay. But I will talk a little bit more about why I don't have an answer and what maybe some of us can start doing about this. But I will not have solutions, and I regard myself as really significantly unqualified to talk to a group like this, except to share with you my understanding of what the problem is with this vast ignorance, this almost systematic ignoring of American band traditions, even within American music scholarship itself. When I first began to teach classes in the history of American music, I got myself, you know, a good textbook, and I eventually decided on what I think basically is a very good book, which is H. Wiley Hitchcock's Music in the United States, A Historical Introduction, which has gone through about 4 editions now. And Wiley Hitchcock, much to his credit, discusses the American band tradition and gives it a good deal of prominence, particularly in his discussion of 19th century American music, and he takes it through the importance of John Philip Sousa and his contemporaries. It is treated as a separate topic, and then, rather amazingly, when we get to the 20th century, it disappears. It disappears from the narrative. A couple of weeks ago, I was at my own conference, a national annual meeting of the Society for American Music that took place in Cincinnati. Some of you may know about the Society for American Music. It was actually formed in 1974 as an offshoot of the American Musicological Society. It was formed by a group of scholars interested in American music who decided the American Musicological Society was badly named because the first part of its name had nothing to do with what it did. The American Musicological Society was a society which essentially studied European-oriented art music and scholarship of European-oriented art music. A good indication of where the AMS, American Musicological Society, was in 1974, which is when I also attended my first meeting of it, was that the distinguished German scholar Karl Dahlhaus gave the keynote lecture and gave it in German with the expectation that everyone would understand it, of course. Yeah. You can't be a scholar in America in musicology and not understand a talk in German, right? Well, scholars and other people interested in American music felt that American music was so badly marginalized by the so-called American Musicological Society that they formed their own organization. And it was originally called the Sonnenk Society, S-O-N-N-E-N-K, after Oscar Sonnenk, who was one of the first music librarians in the Library of Congress, and who made an enormous contribution to the collection of American music there. And it since has changed its name to the Society for American Music, SAM. The Society for American Music has been so successful that now the American Musicological Society has constant room in its publications and on its programs for American music. And we're sort of wondering, you know, what's our next chapter at this point. But I brought up in the meeting that although it has been an enormous success story over the last 30 years for American music scholarship, it is now widely promoted as an area of expertise for young musicologists who are studying music. In fact, over the past 10 years, I think it's safe to say I basically do American music. I have had more doctoral advisees than all of my colleagues put together simply because, not because I'm good, but because they want to study American music. We have that situation, and yet within the Society for American Music, I pointed out that there are still marginalized areas of American music scholarship. How ironic that American music, that viewed itself as a whole marginalized field within music scholarship, now still had areas within the purview of American music scholarship that remain marginalized. And I identified three, but there are probably many more. First was band music. Second was religious music, sacred music of many and all traditions, and the third was pre-20th century American music. And people agreed with me that this was true. So the issue is known. And why it should have happened, well, I really don't know, but what I want to do for the next few minutes is try to argue for an alternative view of the history of American music, one which puts band music squarely at the center. And to do this, I'm not going to have to venture far from standard narratives of who the great American composers of the 20th century are. I'm simply going to have to identify what is missing in most discussions of these composers. Three composers who frequently come up when the list of great American composers is drawn up are Charles Ives, Duke Ellington, and George Gershwin. And I'm just going to pull those three out of a hat as representatives. I could choose others, and there are many, many more examples of what I'm going to offer you that I could offer from the work of other composers. But basically, the point I want to make about all these three composers is that their output is incomprehensible, both from the standpoint of its ever existing and from the standpoint of our understanding it, without a knowledge of American band traditions. In the case of Charles Ives, many of his most famous works stem obviously from reminiscences of his boyhood regarding the sounds of American bands growing up in Danbury, Connecticut in the late 19th century. Putnam's Camp is a very famous example of this. The orchestral piece, The Fourth of July, is another famous example of this. These pieces are very wonderful and very curious in many ways, because what Ives is asking professional symphony orchestra musicians to do in Putnam's Camp and Fourth of July, in effect, is to play like inspired amateur bands. He writes in all the missed rhythms, wrong notes, joyful missed notes into the pieces so that professional musicians can learn how to play this music like it should really sound. As Ives once wrote as marginalia in one of his pieces, band music. Sometimes they played it right, and sometimes they didn't, and it was equally good either way. So you have a great paradox here, which is Ives writing music, first of all, for symphony orchestras, not for bands, moving the inspiration that he took from the band tradition into a different, more self-conscious, more self-consciously cultivated, I use that word in quotation marks, tradition, that of the symphony orchestra, in the hope of enriching the sound world of the symphony orchestra, and at the same time using the symphony orchestra in an almost paradoxical way to help preserve the sounds of American small town bands. The tremendous problem that one gets in performing Ives, and this is true not only of the orchestra pieces, it's true of the songs, it's true of just about anything, is that Ives's music is complex enough in its notation and technical demands that you have to be a well-schooled musician to play it. On the other hand, if you just play the notes, it absolutely dies on the page. And I don't know if you have ever had, as I have had, the very uncomfortable experience of listening to a very well-intentioned singer trained in lieder traditions try to sing Charles Ives as if he were Schubert or Schumann. It absolutely does not work any more than playing the Fourth of July or Putnam's Camp as if it were Brahms would not work. What one has to do, which is again brings up this sort of paradoxical aspect of Ives's output, is learn the complicated notes and rhythms and so forth, and then play them as if they were the most natural thing imaginable, as if they were the sounds coming out of somebody's backyard in New England. Utterly unartsy, utterly unselfconscious. It's very difficult to do, really. And again, it brings up this dual aspect of Ives. the paradox. Bands versus orchestras, professionals versus amateurs, the letter of the score versus the spirit of the score. On a certain level, I think Ives knew that the American band tradition that he loved so much, in fact, much of the traditions of community music making, were being endangered as America moved into the 20th century. As America became increasingly urbanized, populations more segmented and more fragmented, as eventually the radio and the phonograph began to replace the parlor piano as the instrument that one found in the typical living room, Ives felt that the traditions of communal music making were being lost. And he felt that by writing the way he did for those revered institutions, the symphony orchestras, he could somehow preserve them, paradoxically, by taking them out of the realm in which he had heard them and putting them into the realm of professional music making. His work eventually poses more questions than it provides answers to, and the paradoxes that it presents, I think, reflect our modern condition in many ways, which is why so many of Ives' pieces, if you look at the whole span of the pieces, for example, the three places in New England, Putnam's Camp is the middle movement. The last movement is the Housatonic at Stockbridge, which ends with a wonderful unresolved sigh in the string instruments. The famous Concord Sonata ends on a very gentle open dissonance. Ives likes to leave his works open because they represent the kind of questioning that I have indicated is part of the artistic substance of those works themselves. But the whole point here, and I hope I haven't lost it in these circling paradoxes, is that it is absolutely impossible to understand what Ives was about or even how to play his music properly without some appreciation of American band tradition, what those things sounded like, and what they meant to the people who played the music and what they meant to Ives as a person who grew up in that environment. So, for any study of Ives, band music should be an essential part of the understanding and the repertory. Now, if we turn to someone like Duke Ellington, we all know that the jazz band itself is a special outgrowth of 19th century American bands. The orchestra, of course, has always had this aura of greater respect than bands, hasn't it? Unfortunately, you know, this may be one of the reasons why Ives wrote so many pieces for orchestra, although he used the orchestra to get at band sounds. He wanted the respect of that tradition to come for this music that he loved so much. It is fascinating to me that throughout his entire career, Duke Ellington called his wonderful jazz bands orchestras. If you look at the labels, they all say Duke Ellington and his orchestra. And as we get further along in the career, it says Duke Ellington and his famous orchestra. You just think, why didn't he call it a band? I mean, these really were bands in any meaningful sense of the word, but somehow, you know, orchestra has more clout, doesn't it? It has greater cachet in the world. And again, so this is the paradox. I mean, Ellington's music, all jazz, is inescapably coming out of the American band traditions, the way the instruments were played, the choice of instruments themselves, and yet somehow people want to view this as something different, or at least the conductors wanted to have their ensembles viewed as orchestras. With Ellington, of course, there's no question that if you want to understand the music, you have to go to the recorded source. The issue that is raised with Ellington's music, and with that of all of the great classic jazz composers, is how do you best preserve this tradition in a living form? And now, of course, we have the jazz repertory bands, or perhaps jazz repertory orchestras, that play this music, which raises, of course, the question is, in a very, very basic way, if you have a music that is based on improvisation, and certainly although a great deal of Ellington's work was written down, there was always room for improvisation, and the piece was never played through exactly the same way twice, how do you best preserve that tradition? Is it best preserved by training people to play as if they were in the Ellington band, playing the Ellington arrangements, or would it perhaps be better served by having a greater flexibility in approach to it? How would Ellington have wanted his music to be preserved? I don't have answers to these questions. What I do know is that any attempt to understand any aspect of jazz or Duke Ellington's jazz or Duke Ellington as a great composer is doomed from the outset if it is undertaken without a knowledge of the band tradition out of which jazz comes, which explains the instrumentation, the way the instruments are played, the way the instruments should sound. Turning now briefly to Gershwin, it's important to remember that Gershwin's signature piece, Rhapsody in Blue, was composed for a dance band, Paul Whiteman's band, which of course he called an orchestra. Well, how do you get respect, right? If you have a band and you want to have it get respect, you call it an orchestra. Evidently, this is part of this strange history. So if you look at the labels for any of the recordings that Gershwin made with the Paul Whiteman band, it reads Paul Whiteman and his orchestra. Right? But Paul Whiteman had a dance band, and in fact, the whole history of Rhapsody in Blue is inseparable from band music. Whiteman got to know Gershwin's music being the director of the pit band for George White's Scandals of 1922, in which the famous Gershwin tune, I'll Build a Stairway to Paradise, was introduced. Many of you may know this story, but it's such an amusing and precious story that I'll tell it anyway, and bear with me if you've heard it before. During 1923, Whiteman, who had been very impressed with the young Gershwin's music, spoke in a very general way to Gershwin about, you know, you should write me a jazz concerto someday. And Gershwin said, you know, oh sure, as if Whiteman had said, let's go to China someday, because Gershwin did not view this as anything serious at the time. And the thing was just allowed to be to rest until one morning, early in January 1924, in the early morning hours, George and his brother Ira, who was to become his favorite and most frequent lyricist, were up in a New York pool hall, which is what they like to do in the early hours of the morning. And at that time, by about 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, you could get the first edition of the morning newspaper. And Ira, as he always did, would turn to the arts page and say, hey, George, it says here that you're composing a jazz concerto for Paul Whiteman that's going to be premiered in Aeolian Hall in 5 weeks. The expression on George's face has not been recorded, but we can guess what it was by the fact that he was very quickly on the phone to Paul Whiteman saying, I can't do this. And Whiteman saying, yes, you can, and you better, because we've printed the programs already. So Gershwin, as was typical of him, went to work, although it turned out not to be a jazz concerto, but a Rhapsody in Blue, and it was written for Whiteman's ensemble of the time, which was based on a dance band instrumentation. It certainly had some strings, but only violins and a single string bass with lots of winds and players who doubled on wind and brass instruments. Gershwin's career is, of course, inseparable from Rhapsody in Blue, so we can't understand Rhapsody in Blue and Gershwin's career without understanding the kind of ensemble for which it was written and what it originally sounded like. And fortunately, Gershwin recorded Rhapsody in Blue with the personnel of the original Whiteman band for which it was arranged in 1924. Now, important point, Whiteman had his house arranger, Ferdy Groffet, of Grand Canyon Suite fame, and the understanding was from the beginning that Groffet would orchestrate from Gershwin's two piano scores, since only Groffet knew the secrets of the Whiteman band, such as the fact that the same person played string, bass, and tuba. And therefore, these parts could exist in alternation, but not at the same time. So Groffet did the orchestration, and we have this recording from June 1924 that shows us what the Rhapsody in Blue sounded like in its original incarnation. And I don't know how many of you have heard this, but whenever I play it for students, they are absolutely astounded because it feels to them as if they really never heard the piece before. Could we hear the beginning of the Rhapsody in Blue from the 1924 recording, please? Thank you. what students hear, and which might not surprise you, of course, if you've heard this, but it's what surprises students, is that Rhapsody in Blue, at least in its original incarnation, was a sassy sounding piece that did not take itself terribly unduly seriously, that sounded like the players were having a lot of fun doing it. This has unfortunately been lost, I think, in a lot of the traditions of the performance of Rhapsody in Blue. Why? Because how did Rhapsody in Blue become an internationally famous circulating piece? Because Ferdi Grofe quickly made an arrangement for symphony orchestra, right? And it is in that arrangement, with a full body of strings and so forth, in which it is frequently played, at a tempo that is sometimes about half that on much of the original Whiteman recording, and with the consequence that the piece has sounded a lot more serious, and I would say at some points even leaden, than it was originally designed to sound. But again, we have the paradox that because it was arranged for standard symphony orchestra, it was able to traverse the world. The original jazz band arrangement is done very occasionally, but all too rarely, and I'll just play for you the very beginning of what I consider to be a fantastic, very recent recording of this by the New York Harmony Ensemble, conducted by Stephen Richmond, in which the original Grofe arrangement is used, and the players have obviously studied the Gershwin and Whiteman original very carefully, because they capture the spirit of it perfectly, but in wonderfully realized modern sound. And unlike the Gershwin and Whiteman recordings, this one is complete. So it enables us to get some idea of what audiences might actually have heard when Rhapsody in Blue was first premiered in 1924. And it gives us an idea of the kick they must have gotten from it. So let's hear a little of that, please. By Richmond and the New York Harmony Ensemble, which contains other arrangements of Gershwin songs by Grofe, I hardly recommend it to you. It's a really revelatory kind of recording. And what comes out from this and from a study of the original Gershwin recording with Whiteman is something about the Gershwin style that is seconded by all the recordings we have of Gershwin playing the piano, by all the recordings we have by singers such as Fred Astaire, who worked with Gershwin, by any recordings in which Gershwin was involved, which is the characteristic Gershwin style, and not just for piano, but for everything, is a style that tends toward the staccato, the accented, the rhythmically sharp. In other words, a style that is based on a band sound, not on a legato string sound, but on a band sound. And this, again, indicates the extent to which the band, both historically with Rhapsody in Blue, but also the sounds of bands, are essential to understanding the work of Gershwin. People may not know, and I have no idea if when the Seattle Opera does Porgy and Bess this summer, they will do this. It's not done often, but in Porgy and Bess, in the scene before the picnic on Kittiwa Island, Gershwin actually, in his original score, instructed for there to be an onstage band playing, which, again, in the middle of his opera, bringing in, again, a band to, in a sense, what should we say, reassert the roots of his style and what it should sound like. With this little, very spotty survey, I hope I've indicated to you a kind of revisionist musicology, which would place the band, its styles, and its traditions at the center of the greatest 20th century American music, not at the margins. In terms of what can be done to restore band music to a central position, which it clearly needs to be, again, I really don't know, except to say that all the sages that I know operating in various areas tell us that the most meaningful work is always local and incremental, that the global solutions that come down from the top rarely work very well. So I would encourage you to do what you're probably all doing already, and excuse me because I know I'm preaching to the choir, but you can ask and prod your colleagues who are orchestra conductors, musicologists, theorists, you know, do you teach any band music? Do you teach the importance of the traditions? Well, why not? You know, maybe you should look at this piece, or maybe you should consider that. I'm sure you probably are all doing your own job of moving your own work away strictly from the margins by sharing concerts with other kinds of groups, making community contacts, putting the band tradition back into American communities from which it came and where it absolutely finally belongs. There are no grand solutions here, but we might take some perverse comfort in knowing that if bands have remained somewhat marginalized in the American music traditions and in the current situation, all of our musical organizations are in trouble now, including the very prestigious symphony orchestras and opera companies. We only need to read the art sections of the newspapers to find out that this is true. And what you can do, I suppose, is turn to your symphony colleagues or opera colleagues and say, well, you know, you're feeling marginalized and in trouble. Welcome to the club. And let's all hang together, because if not, we will assuredly hang separately. Thank you very much. Thank you. I have time for a question or comment or two if anybody has any, or, you know, I can certainly converse if people want to come up briefly afterwards. Anybody? Okay, well then, thank you again. It was a privilege to address you. And, oh yeah, question or comment, please.
Is there any tradition for adding a chorus in the middle? I remember hearing a very old recording, I think it was an original, that there's a chorus in the middle section of Rhapsody in Blue.
The gentleman asked if there's any tradition for having a chorus in the middle section of Rhapsody in Blue. Certainly not in Gershwin's lifetime. Is this on the famous melody, ba-da-da-da-da? Yeah, I was going to call attention to that melody to show you how Gershwin in the Rhapsody in Blue has this one lyrical tune, which is the exception that proves the rule, that he puts it, you know, right in the middle of the piece so that it serves as a contrast to all this more band-like music. There is no tradition that I'm aware of for doing that. However, the Rhapsody in Blue has been arranged, as many of you know, for anything and everything, including, and I'm not making this up, an ensemble of 8 banjos that I heard once. So. Any other comments or questions? Okay. Well, again, thank you. It's a privilege to speak before you, and best of luck to you all.